Hey guys, today I have Sandra Seifert here today, and she is actually Miss Philippines Earth and Miss Earth Air. And she's going to give us her perspective of what is true beauty, and she's going to share with us a little bit of experience of being a Miss Earth. So check it out. All right, so Sandra, tell us a little bit of what Miss Earth is. You know, I've never actually heard about it before. So,
really?
Yeah, I think the audience would like to know what is Miss Earth?
Okay, so Miss Earth is actually a pageant. It's considered one of the top three pageants in the world, just because a lot of countries participate in this pageant. So you might be familiar with Miss Universe or Miss World, but Miss Earth is like the top third pageant. And essentially what this pageant does is it advocates for environmental projects, but they use beauties for a cause. In other words, they search for women that have advocacies geared towards the environment, but are also beautiful, because with that physical beauty, they can attract different people and call their attention towards an advocacy.
Okay, so environmental projects and...
Yes, and essentially what happens is the moment you get crowned, you get really, really busy. While other pageants might open opportunities for modeling and, let's say, gigs on TV, with Miss Earth, you start working with the government, you start working with non-government organizations as well, different NGOs, you work with schools, and
You meet celebrities too, right?
You meet celebrities as well, yes.
You met the famous
boxer Manny Pacquiao, yeah, definitely.
A South Lake show of that.
You meet a lot of influential people because you are also asked to speak in behalf of the environment and your advocacy. But one of the projects that's so dear to me as a Miss Earth is the school tours that we do. So every winning batch annually would conduct school tours.
Okay.
And what happens is you go to different schools, whether it be private or local schools, especially in the Philippines, where I won, and you start teaching the kids in classrooms. One example of what we would teach is 10 tips on how to go green. So instead of the 10 commandments, we teach them 10 tips to go green and be more eco-friendly. Aside from that, we also plant trees. We are invited to different provinces to do so. And depending on your advocacy, in my case, it was proper waste management and waste segregation. I would also get my hands dirty and start segregating waste with local people in provinces so they understand this concept of recycling better.
Oh, wow. That's awesome.
Yeah, we did a lot during our year.
So it's very beneficial to the earth, you know? You're really teaching people about how to take care of the environment.
Yes. Yeah. So we educate them, especially the youth, through the school tours. And then we also speak to prominent people about projects. We fundraise sometimes for certain projects. And we go out into nature and really enhance with our hands nature through tree planting activities, as I said.
So that sounds like a very positive experience. Mm-hmm. But I know that there's something you told me about that you kind of had a bit of a negative experience in this being a Miss Earth. And, you know, I just wanted you to kind of share with everyone what you went through.
Well, essentially in the aspect of giving back to Mother Earth and protecting Mother Earth, I think that was a wonderful experience. I would not trade that for anything, because it really allowed us to be impactful and help the environment and educate people. But one thing that I guess had a more negative effect on me personally was just that, you know, the focus was so much on like outward appearance,
right,
and there was just like a lot of pressure to always look good on
right.
a day-to-day basis, even if we sometimes just wanted to be our normal selves and maybe chill on the couch, you know what I mean? So there's a certain expectation that comes with being a beauty queen, and I'm not saying it's wrong, because we are public figures and women look up to us and, you know, have a certain respect already for who we are, but then we have to always live up to that expectation.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, one thing is that I also missed being myself, you know, because I really have to be proper. But more importantly, this whole focus on outward adorning, physical appearance, was something that didn't make me feel too comfortable long term, Shion, because I really feel that true beauty should come from the inside, and people should also get to know who we are on the inside, not just for our projects, but really who we are as as women inside.
And you mentioned to me, because you have to pass your crown to the next Miss Earth. And so you told me something about what you felt when you passed that crown. What did you feel?
Yeah, so I realized that when you were the woman of the year or Miss Earth for that year in particular, all the offers would come to you and everyone was just like, quote unquote, I guess, worshiping you. Like they would, you know, offer you photo shoots, magazine covers, projects. You earn really good money for that 1 year that you win. But the moment you pass on your crown, all the attention focuses and shifts to the new winner. And from feeling so valued and special and beautiful, suddenly you almost feel like empty and worthless and less beautiful. And it was like quite a shock for me, and it is hard to deal with because you know, you're used to just getting all the attention from everyone when you win that crown, and suddenly you pass it over to someone else and people just don't really mind you anymore. They focus on the new winner. And so that was for me also something rather difficult to deal with, and I really did feel kind of alone at one point and almost hit rock bottom.
So is this something that do you think most women kind of experience when they do pass that crown to the next
person? I'm sure it definitely is a shared experience. Some women deal better with it than others. Thankfully, I had found my faith back to the Lord, because when you feel really alone and you realize that your value isn't supposed to be based on just your physical appearance or your title among, you know, men in particular, or humans, you know, I realized that there is a way to feel valued every second of your life by someone, and that someone is Christ. It's the Lord. And I'm so thankful that the Lord basically moved my heart and encouraged me to open the scriptures again and read my Bible. And that's when I came across really important verses that are found in, let's say, Colossians chapter 3, verse 2, which says that we should set our affections on things above, not on things on the earth. And also, I think 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 25, where, you know, we are so focused on achieving things on earth and winning, let's say, temporary crown, a perishable crown, but what we should really be doing is aiming for an imperishable crown. That crown of life that only Christ can give us, that we can receive through eternal life.
That's awesome.
So here I was wearing a Miss Earth crown, but maybe I should have been focusing on a Miss New Earth crown instead. You know, that heavenly crown that
like
no one
that.
Can take away and that I don't have to pass on.
The crown that God gives you.
Amen. And we're faithful till the end.
So I think that's something that a lot of girls are struggling with out there. You know, I was telling you, a lot of people, a lot of girls especially, I think, want to lose weight. They want to look good and impress guys and kind of value themselves depending on how they look.
True. You know?
So their beauty is based on their outer look. But you're mentioning right now that it's about what's in the inside, who you are. And so to you, what is a true beauty to you? Like, what does that look like to you inside?
So what you were saying is very accurate. There was also a time where I felt really that my value was based on my physical appearance, and if I look good, more guys would like me and pay attention to me. But, you know, at the end of the day, you're absolutely right. It's not about how we look, because looks fade. And even, let's say, if we invest so much of our time, money, and effort on physical appearances, through workouts, through clothes, makeup, heels, designer branded bags, etc. At the end of the day, you know, that is just transient and temporary. It doesn't last. I mean, whether you end up dying in life, or whether you, let's say, you have a killer body, but suddenly you have an accident, and then, you know, like, you never really know what could happen, but there's so much risk that you could lose all of that, versus investing in a beauty type that is lasting and that no one can take away from you. And I've realized through the Bible particularly that true beauty is all about inner beauty, more specifically character. Mm. So character is the one thing that no one can take away from us. Mm. Character is lasting, and character is what we will take with us from this world to the next, wow. right? So instead of focusing too much on our outward appearance and like how pretty our dresses and shoes are, we should be focusing on the beauty of our character, dressing the soul is what they say. And there's a beautiful verse for that that really hit me hard, and it's found in 1 Timothy chapter 2 verses 9 and 10, and it specifically focuses on women dressing in modest apparel with shamefacedness and sobriety, and focusing on good works, meaning good characters.
I think that's good, because God wants us to be modest and inside, and then that should show on the outside, right?
Exactly. Yeah. There's a book written by Ellen White called Education, and she wrote there that, if the heart is right, so if our characters are right, our dress, our words, and our acts will all be right. Everything, the true change and true beauty development starts in the heart and then just radiates outward. So essentially, our dress is an index of our heart and our character.
Yep.
We dress the way we feel, right?
Right.
And basically, if we have a heart for Jesus, we would dress the way Jesus would want us to dress, which is modestly.
That's awesome. And so I know this is something you're really passionate about now, like the true beauty and being modest in how you dress. And so tell us something that you're doing right now, like the company you have now. And
So when I found out about this, remember, after I turned over my crown, I realized that God was so caring about inner beauty. I just started to work on my own character, and I started to take opportunities that were out there to share about this principle and concept of beauty with different women, which then evolved into, I guess you could call it, a ministry, because I was invited to share about modesty and dress and character. And then when women would ask me what could they wear now, since they knew that the true principles of modest dressing were, let's say, skirts below the knees or at ankle length, covering, most of our skin as much as possible. Less skin exposure is more appropriate and modest. Women wanted to start dressing that way, and they needed to know where they could find such apparel. And I personally, as I was sharing these things, also was looking for clothing like that. But I noticed, Shion, that whenever I tried to shop for these kinds of items, that there would always be some form of compromise in the fashion. So if I would go to the mall or to a shop and look for skirts, I'd find a long skirt, but there would be like a really high slit or the fabric would be see-through. Or I'd find a long sleeve top, but the neckline would be really low or plunging, or the back would be really open. So it was hard to find items that were absolutely modest, to the point where I decided to look for a seamstress that could just execute my designs and sew dresses for me to wear on Sabbath. And that's what I did. I wore my own designs just for me. And when I would share in different churches about principles in modesty and dress, the women approached me after and wanted to also access such clothing and asked me where I got it. And since I told them I would just make it for me, to keep me in prayers, because at some point in God's perfect time, if it's His will, I hope to start a clothing brand that could cater to this, department of fashion, which is modest clothing. And true enough, God answered this prayer in His time. And we now have a fashion brand that focuses on customized fashion, but encourages modest design. And
you're wearing that dress, right?
Yeah. So today I'm wearing just an example of what a modest summer dress could look like. This can also be used for Sabbath, provided we're like in warm climate. The brand is called Suravilla, and it was actually named after my mother's maiden name, because she's one of the women I look up to in life, and she always encouraged me to dress more modestly and appropriately.
Okay, cool.
So yeah, that's what I've been doing. We launched a brand on Instagram, so it's a pure online brand. We do custom designs, so we basically produce any design, but we do encourage modest design. Mm. And I've also put up some examples of Sabbath dresses, so mm-hmm. you could either shop those designs in your size. We measure women if we have the opportunity to measure them, because we believe that every woman was fearfully and wonderfully made. Mm-hmm. So it's nice to also measure them so that they can dress according to their body type without having to make adjustments to what's available just in the world.
And nice. And I really think this is awesome what you're doing, because it's really teaching ladies that you don't have to wear those type of dress you were talking about earlier mm-hmm. to look beautiful. Mm-hmm. You know, you still could wear these modest clothes.
Absolutely.
And be attractive in a way, but the true attraction is coming from your heart, you know? And so that's a cool concept that you have.
Yeah. Yes, the feedback has been amazing. We've also managed to dress some really influential people. For one, the choir of the Office of the President of the Philippines.
Yeah,
so that was a wonderful project. They're very modest as well. And then several celebrities in the Philippines. So you could definitely check out the brand on Instagram. One of our best-selling products is, Sabbath dresses, and of course the jumpsuits, because that's kind of the modern day power suit, since women are so active and they just go from A to B, and like from the workspace to the home, but they're active and need to still kind of look appropriate. Uh-huh. Jumpsuits have caught on trend fast when it comes to our product.
So that might be good for our F5 ladies.
Active movement. Surely could appreciate those kinds of designs. But more importantly, I want to add to what you said, Shion, which is that by dressing in a respectful and modest way, you can actually get people and even men to respect you just by how you dress. Because a lot of women struggle with that. You know, some women, they wonder, like, why a guy checks them out in a certain way or starts saying certain things like, hey, sexy, or like, want to go on a date? You know what I mean? Like, they'll start talking to you in a certain way, even without knowing you. And some women, they wonder why.
Uh-huh.
Like, you do get the attention maybe that you're looking for as a woman, but you want the right kind of attention, and you want to attract the right kind of men.
Yes.
And the only way to do that is to also kind of dress the right way. If you dress modestly, you will attract a man that appreciates modesty and that most likely cares more about your inner beauty and character rather than your physical appearance.
I agree. Yeah. And that's something that it would help guys too. Like,
Absolutely.
Guys struggle with girls not being modest.
Yes.
And we fall into temptations.
Correct.
And so that really does help us guys too in a way. And
yeah.
So that's a good point.
That is a very good point, because what women need to understand is that men are very visual creatures by nature. And so they respond to what they see. And when a woman dresses provocatively, it can really provoke a man. It stimulates his mind. And, he could start developing certain thoughts that you would probably not want him to develop. And therefore, we can either be a blessing to men or a stumbling block with what we wear. I'd just like to quickly share a study that I believe Harvard did. They actually gathered together a group of men and they showed them two images, and they asked the men to choose what arouses them more, a woman that is naked or a woman that is dressed in a mini skirt. And can you guess what got more votes?
I'm just gonna say it was the mini skirt, just
because you know the answer.
She
answered.
Typically,
my testimony.
People will probably say naked picture, but in that study, it was the
mini. Actually, most men said that they get more aroused by seeing a woman in a mini skirt rather than a woman that's naked.
Wow.
And it makes sense, because they explained why. They said that when a woman is naked, they basically see everything. But when a woman is dressed in a mini skirt, there is a little room for the imagination, and there's curiosity, because you don't fully see everything revealed or exposed, but you still see a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And so they start to imagine things. Again, we go back to this concept of men being visual creatures by nature. So that's an interesting study, and therefore, we women, we just sometimes we want to be practical, or we think like it's so hot, so we'll put on a mini skirt or we'll put on shorts, but we also have to be mindful of the impact that it has on men.
Yeah, it's true. And so these are, it may seem like small things, but it's something that has a huge impact.
Even when it comes to a woman's safety, right? I think I read somewhere, again by Ellen White, that a woman can protect herself from 1,000 perils by dressing properly and modestly. So not only can you command respect by how you dress, but you can also protect yourself and remain safe if you dress more modestly, because you don't want to get into the wrong mindset of a man by being a stumbling block and being provocative. So that's something I can definitely encourage.
That's really good information that you're giving us right now. That's
awesome. Praise God. I'm glad I also learned about it, because I didn't know better too. And I used to really dress that way before, fully decked, you know, with a lot of makeup, like a lot of effort to make my hair beautiful, you know, high heels, fitted dresses, because women often want to also, they're proud of, you know, the hard work they put into their bodies and being in shape. And I don't discount that, because that's wonderful that women take care of themselves so well, but you know, you don't have to like walk around in a mini skirt and in a bikini just for people to appreciate that beauty and that effort of yours. There are ways to dress where, you know, you can be modest, but then through the proper fit and silhouette, people can still appreciate that you work out and that you're in shape.
I agree. So, but yeah, thank you so much for what you're sharing with us right now.
Welcome.
It's something that's, I really think that a lot of ladies are going to appreciate. And for you guys, you know, I hope you guys could take this into your heart. And I really wanted to talk to Sandra about this topic, because like I said earlier, I feel like a lot of us struggle with, we do fitness and try to be healthy for our outer looks. But I think our purpose should be for our inner beauty.
Yes.
And so I believe fitness teaches us about discipline and character growth, you know, all these things. So I feel like those are the things that we should be focusing. And you said our character is what we're going to take to heaven.
Amen.
I really like that.
Yes.
And so thank you so much for what you shared. And
you're welcome, Sharon. Thank you for having me.
Yeah. And I hope you guys found this really interesting, and just look into it more yourself. All right.
Yeah, and you can follow us on Instagram as well. My personal account is at Sandra Seifert. The clothing line is at Suravilla Official.
Okay.
And let's continue the conversation there.
All right. All right, check it out. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.